God has an expectation. God has a plan to see his expectation met. But a generation must come in alignment. And we say yes to Jesus. Ibarasia tabo mekababa kamande kaidatos. We withhold nothing, Jesus. You want a generation. We offer you on. Let the waitings come to an end.
In the Eagles Conference, let me borrow you some wisdom. You will need to listen again and again and again and again and again before you can come into those things. What you may have now as notes is what you can preach from. But the proof that you were present is that you embodied. I've downloaded all the messages that have been uploaded, and I've started my listening. So begin to listen. Begin to listen. Begin to listen. When God speaks to us as congregations, it is wisdom to labor listening again and again until we find ourselves in what was generally said. So there are utterances that were given in Makodi that somebody stood up to say, I'm the one, that you are the one. Are you with me? Because God knew, and that's one of the benefits of God's all-knowing dimension, he knew that you were going to be listening or streaming. And so there were utterances that were given that did not define anybody's reality in Makodi that were your own. Somebody just fell down and says, this one. I've learned ministering. I can't remember the last, was that? Yeah, I think it was in 10 hours. I was looking for a particular lady who had been abused by a minister. And even though Jesus was in the bid to scale her up into her office, there was an intercessory horn that was installed, that was not active because of bitterness. And I asked the Lord to help me find the person. So they brought somebody that fell. And if you watched, when the person came, I looked at the person and said, see, we are not cunning men. There are ways to know that even though this person failed, it's not this person. So I quickly announced, God is doing many things, not this one. And you know, he's setting yourself up, because we have not seen another person fall down. But the one who spoke confirmed who it was. And when the person was brought, it was obvious that it was the person. So, please listen again and again. Make sure that you don't miss out on any of the sessions. Pay the price of data so that you can have a future. May God give you understanding. All of the services I streamed with my data, not your data, because I understand prices. And you know, YouTube digests data like water. So once it's done, again, just so that we can embody what is being communicated. So you can go on their pages. At least I know on Papa's Telegram channel, quite a number of the messages. I think 7 of the messages. And there are a lot of messages. Even this morning there was a service. This morning was ordination service. And Papa went beyond a boundary. If you have been looking for the 12 civilizations of heaven, he went beyond the 2. He actually wanted to stop at 2, but he went beyond. So you have a few more. You have a few more. So that's the cheat code for this morning's session. All right. Matthew chapter 24, and I want to do a long reading from verse 1 to 12. The path of waiting. Now, when I enter into the part of waiting, I'll let you know. But this is my initial discourse. Please keep your eyes on the screen if you're close to the screen, so that you don't miss any detail. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him to show him the buildings of the temple. So this labor by the disciples of Jesus was to furnish Jesus with the knowledge of the temple architecture. What's your name? Maiwa. Okay, so we have 2 Maiwas. So it's like, this is Toluwalogo. Good. So I have a namesake in the house. So, both of you build houses. We don't want to say one of you. And then because you are friends, you go visiting each other, and then it's the job of the house owner or the one who is more acquainted with the house to talk about the house. I remember when Woli built his house before it was officially commissioned. I was there with my wife, and then without furnishing, I think 2 or 3 days before they moved in, we had to go from room to room. Oh, this is this room. Okay, so what is here? This is this. What is here? This is this. Okay. Oh, what kind of material is this? And he was explaining to us. It was a demonstration of a knowing. And then at the end of the building tour, I started crying. The reason why I started crying was that I was crying, appreciating God. See what I've done for my brother. You have tried. One thing my wife didn't hear me say was build my own house, because he didn't promise me any. Are you with me? Okay, you are thinking I'm strange. I have a list of the promises. If he promises me today, I will expect a house. Christian, has Jesus told you that you will build a house? No. Has he told you that you will build a house? Tell me now. Has he told you that you will buy land? He has not told me that I will buy land. So I'm not ambitious. He didn't tell me I will build a house. But we agreed that I will not live under the bridge. And his faithfulness has made it happen. But he told my brother that he will build a house. So he built it for him. Be careful to think that because God did something for your friend, he will do for you. I know the church has committed that error. So that when somebody comes and says, I escaped an accident, the person says, your testimony is next. You be careful with the amens that you say. He didn't promise me. But I cried, Jesus, in the midst of these austere conditions, you made this dream a possibility. We thank you. The disciples seemingly were a lot more accustomed to the architecture of the temple. And so after they had made an end of their labors in the temple, as they were walking out, unknown to them, the workout that Jesus was undertaking was more prophetic than literal. It is to say to us that when you come into the fullness of your reality as a pilgrim, one who is on a journey with the Christ, and the reality of that journey is with the spirit of the Christ. You know, Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 13, that this spirit of truth will guide you into all truth. It means that one of the experiences of the believer is the experience of walks with the spirit. We call them spirit walks. Where you journey from dimension to dimension. Be sensitive. What you see is not always what you get. There are certain things that are not literal, that they are more prophetic than literal. Am I confusing you? You have been listening to the Apostle Gideon Odoma and Papa now, and Reverend Noah. Abi now. So what am I saying that is serious? They were showing him the beauty, because the temple was an architectural masterpiece. The railings, the different dimensions. It was built to host more than men. That's why it was an architectural masterpiece. Apart from its physical beauty, there were offices that were captured in the temple that were angelic. So that you remember when Zechariah was offering the sacrifice according to his lot. The Bible said that an angel appeared on his right side. It means it was possible for angels to function in that building. It's not every church building that angels can function in. Because some were built to only accommodate the priesthood of men. Are you getting me? But that one, God can stream from inside the holies of holies there. Stream so strong that even if priests want to enter, they'll be blocked. May you build well. That's why I'm trying. The first time we had a major giving into that thing, I sent a mail to Ibadan, because that church account is lodged with EFCC. Say, one money entered this account. I don't know the source, because I'm very careful that no strange money enters it. If one block is brought from blood money, Jesus will not live there. Are you with me? That's why it looks as if the work is slow and many of your hearts are failing. If you want to build what will last and you want to build in truth, you see, speed may not be an asset. That's what I'm studying with. We'll get there. So Jesus walked out and they said, "Can you see how beautiful it is? Can you see? After that curtain, you see the Ark of the Covenant. How can you be introducing the Ark of the Covenant to the Christ? See, this altar here is called the altar, the brazen altar. It is upon this altar that they offer the sacrifice of sin." Jesus must have been saying, don't you understand that my cross is replacing this thing? But teach me what I know. So when verse 2, "And Jesus said unto them, See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down." We're going to crash this building. It was a literal statement. It was also a prophetic statement, because that building was only supposed to be a building foreshadowing God's agenda for temple existence. That we're going to move from what is built with hands, because God does not live in temples built with hands. He's a visitor in that temple. God's original agenda for occupation in the earth is a man. That's what he was saying prophetically, but literally too, he was speaking, or yes, foretelling the destruction of the temple. That's the invasion of the enemies of Israel that culminated in the breaking down of that temple. At a time will come when there will be no two stones upon themselves. Let's go on. We're going to 12, so let's move. "And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives," so there was a journey from the temple to the Mount of Olives. What happened in that journey was not told unto us. "The disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be?" What things? The things you just said. It meant that, I don't know the distance, and I'm sorry I didn't labor to find out the distance. I'll have been able to tell you how far. Even if it was 3-4 kilometers, the disciples must have been pondering on his words. And let's take a side stream to also remind ourselves that, you see, it is the word that you ponder upon that benefits you. It's not the one that you hear. They must have been ruminating in their hearts. No two stones. Is it possible? What will happen? So when he sat on the Mount of Olives, they saw that he had come to rest. They decided to choose his rest time to query him. May God give you understanding that when you want to query people, you must wait till they are resting. "Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" They decided to extrapolate the subject matter, which was stones not sitting on themselves in the temple, to use the privilege of Jesus' rest time to ask many questions. I don't know what you do when you sense that the presence of God in tangible dimensions has come to rest on your altar, I don't know what you do. Maybe what you do is just keep speaking in tongues. Or what you do is to ask questions many times in understanding that you have been trying to ask. As we journey tonight, I will get you to a place where I will make you know that many of the questions in your heart are actually valid questions. Is Godwin around? Okay. It was in my house. If Godwin and Oba had a foretaste, and my wife, Sha, of this teaching, there are questions you are asking yourselves that you have not bothered to ask the Lord because you think that he doesn't answer questions. One of the things you must know as we begin to relate more with the Holy Spirit is that he is a speaking spirit, but he doesn't talk much. He rather answers much. So the one who has not, you know, entered into the shape of a seeker, who will ask him questions again and again and again, will be cheated. And you will not be able to say to the Lord that I don't know. You have not, because you ask not. That thing you are trying to ask Toluwalogo, say, why is this thing? You should ask him. Mary understood how to function like that. I've heard everything you said. But if I'm going to participate in what you want to do, how shall these things be? When we ask those questions, many people who raised us told us that it's wrong to, you cannot question God. You see, when intimacy goes from sharing and it becomes partnership, there is no accurate partnership where understanding is not furnished. And one of the things to unlock the gates of understanding is that you ask the Lord questions. If the Lord says, go and win 1,000 souls, don't run. Let him know, Lord, I'm willing. How shall these things be? There is a process. So whisper to your neighbor, there is a process. You are not wise. Tell them, you are not wise. Because you know what to do. If you don't know how to do it, you are still foolish. Are they angry? The person is supposed to be sober. Because there are a lot of people who know what to do, they don't know how to do it, and they've started running. If Jesus tells you what to do, it's Jesus that will tell you how to do it. That's how it functions. So they asked him three questions. So when you get home tonight, you can bombard the Lord with as many questions. Open your jotter. Every time you had a question, when you sit, read it out to him. Lord, I have 30 questions. You know, if you tell me 30 questions, there's a tendency for me to forget. He's not like me. So I go for meetings and I say question time. They ask 6 questions and I say, okay, let me start from the 6th one. It's because I can't even remember the first one. But the Lord is not like that. So ask him. Next verse. And Jesus answered, he was not angry, and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive. Go back to verse 3 so that we can travel better. I need to ask, are there any prophecies that you have in custody? Is anything the Lord has said to you like a prophecy? Or you, either directly or by proxy, using the vessel? Any prophecies? Wave your hand. Okay, some of us don't have prophecies. Okay, are there any promises that the Lord has made to you? If you don't have, you need to go to him and say, Lord, promise me. See, God is not committed until he has made a promise. I don't like that look on your face, but what I'm saying is true. That it is written in scripture does not mean that it will automatically happen in your life until it becomes your word. God is not committed to doing it for you. He can do it for another person. These things will make sense because when we begin to speak of waiting, you will find out that the average person who claims he's waiting, he's just wasting time. If we we finish service today, Pastor Diola, and I say, Pastor Diola, I will quickly get something for you. I'm just saying, no. I will quickly get something for you. You know, even if everybody leaves, on the strength of that quickly get something for you, what will you do? You will stay. But if you see me putting my hand in my pocket and I'm talking to you, and then you heard me say, Mayawa, I want to get something for you, will you wait? You see, if you wait, you were just my worst accomplice. Because if a promise is not made to you, then the one who made that promise to that person is not committed to you. So people say, sir, I'm looking for a job. I say, did Jesus promise you job? If he has not promised you, go and seek him for a promise. Because when despondency comes, when despair comes, one of the things that will be your anchor in that day that will not make you compromise is that he promised you. It's like a receipt he leaves in your hand. Faith, Hebrews 11:1, is the substance. It's like a receipt of the things that we hope for. And there is no reason to be hopeful if there is no promise. Are you with me? If you are going home tonight and you say, don't cook, I will give you food. There are two things you will check. Can this guy buy me food? Does he look hungry? If he looks hungry, he's just whining me. So you may just put indomie on fire in case. But if you now go home and say, the way Reverend was looking at me, he looks as if he knows I'll be too tired to cook this night. Let me wait. Man, you'll be hungry for a long time. Because I don't think you look hungry. I'm just staring at you. If you have a promise from God, can you, and you feel that time is happening to that promise, can you, give me verse 3, ask him after this order. These are side talks. Can you also ask him, Lord, when shall these things be? He may not give you a timeline, but there is an information that he will give that will help your life. Because when we ask the Lord questions, he doesn't always answer our questions, but the questioning, initiating a question gives the Lord, how do I put it? Help me, Holy Ghost. When a believer asks the Lord a question, he makes the Lord know. It convinces him that you are willing to know more. And so you can ask him, what is the name of this brother? And he begins to say, tomorrow morning, be careful when you go out. It shows that your heart is ready to receive from him. He may not answer your question. The disciples did not say, how would we get power? What they asked him was, would thou at this time restore the kingdom back to Israel? Acts chapter 1 verse 6. And Jesus began to give them the protocol for the revival. Ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and then you'll be witnesses unto me. That's how I will switch you on. He didn't even go back to discuss the power thing, even the kingdom thing. He even told them that is forbidden knowledge. So ask him, Lord, when? And if there are extra questions, you can add. So if you're writing, I want you to put down these three questions. I want to be very petty teaching this evening. What, when shall these things be? That's an event that has happened in our context. That event has happened in the past, because the two stones have been cast away. That's why there's no physical temple in Israel. What shall be the sign of thy coming? I think that is very important to us, right? And then the last question is, and the end of the world. Because environmentalists say that if we continue like this by so year, the earth will have burnt up. I laugh. what is happening biologically or chemically is not what will destroy the earth. Scriptures is more intelligent than science. Are you with me? So, those were the three questions. Let's run from four. Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you. So Jesus' response was that, you see, very important in answering your timelines, question about timeline, question about the sign of my coming, question about the end of the world, is that you should be careful. Give attention to yourself, because deception is coming. If you will not hear anything this evening, please hear that deception is coming. I don't have a license to give us my perspective as received of the Lord on the journey of deception. But I know. Maybe I give you the tip of the iceberg. Deception to the average believer, like the name, it's not a direct attempt, will not be a direct attempt to weaken your consecration, to weaken your knowledge. It's going to be subtle.
God has an expectation. God has a plan to see his expectation met. But a generation must come in alignment. And we say yes to Jesus. Ibarasia tabo meka baba kamande kaida tosh. We withhold nothing, Jesus. You want a generation? We offer you one. Let the waitings come to an end.